My dad always wanted a son, and he hadn't got any sons, so I thought I would be the son and go into the services for him. But I'd had a nasty operation as a child, and I didn't think, my father, I don't think, thought that I would pass the exam. But I did, A1.
So you were pleased and he was pleased?
Well, he was pleased, but my mum was a bit upset. I don't think she really wanted me to go. But I think they thought that the operation would fail me somehow. March 1940 was when I joined the services. March the 20th, 1940.
Where did you go to join up? Was it Worcester?
At the top of the Butts. They used it after for a factory for duvet things, you know. But it was there that we went in there to join up and for exams, I suppose you would call it, examination. My friend came with me, hoping we should go together. But unfortunately, she passed B, so she could only go in as a cook.
But you were a fighting machine.
So, yes, I was on the barrage balloon. I went in. It was equivalent to the flight mechanics, really. I went first to Bedford to be kitted out. From Bedford, I went over to Morecambe. And then from then, I went down to Cardington in Bedfordshire. That is where they made the 106 air balloon, which as soon as it went up went on fire, didn't it? And I was there, and we had to do our training, cable splicing, rope splicing, fabric patching, and all that sort of thing in that very hangar that they built the 106 in. It was a very hard job in any case, whatever it was, but I mean, doing the splicing, you know, with the wire splicing for the cable, played havoc with your hands. I always remember the corporal. His name was Smith. We called him Smudger. Oh, he was a devil. But he was good. He wouldn't... You've got to be 100% before he would pass you. I mean, you don't realise, seeing them in the sky, how big they are when they're down. They're massive.
How big are they?
I was going to say they reach from the front to the back of this bungalow, and higher than this when they were blown up. They were quite big.
So that's going to be 75 feet, isn't it?
Very long. Big, yeah. They were very big, because, I mean, the ears that we called it, they were massive, you know. And then once a week, we had to go around with the gauge, see if there was any leaks. And if there was, then she'd got to come right down, and we'd got to let down as much as we could to put a patch on. And you had to go inside to put the patch on, in the air part, you know. Because there was an air part underneath. But once you came out, you could do that. But once you had to let the gas go in again to get it up.
Did you wear gas masks?
No.
What was the balloon filled with?
With gas.
What kind of gas?
Well, I suppose it was like this helium stuff, because it kept the balloon up.
I expect it was flammable gas, wasn't it?
Oh, yes, because on the cable itself was fitted a utensil which, if a plane hit the cable, it would fire and the balloon would go up in flames, and it would cut the cable as well, so that it would bring the plane down, the balloon down, and the cable. My first sight was Middlesbrough. The people up there were lovely, the Georges. They were absolutely beautiful people, kind, generous. And they said to us, oh, you'll be all right, we don't have any raids much up here, which we didn't. I was up there 4 months and only had one raid. Well, when we volunteered for London, they sent me first to Upton Park.
What year would that be? 41?
41. I know I was up there when they did 14 days in succession bombing. And then they sent me to another balloon site at Whips Cross.
Did you have any hairy moments?
Well, I did, yes, because I had to bring the balloon down one night because there was a raid going on. I got the crew up. And we got one girl there that was, had too much to drink. So she wouldn't get up. So I went up. I'm shouting the orders and trying to do her job. Now, when they get guys are down so far, that it's a spider and it's like your hand like that would be. So there's a loop like that, and each rope is tied in there to steady the back of it. And I tried to do that, and one of the ropes, because we were one person short, was going through the spider. There's like, it was like a wheel. Well, if it had gone through there, it could have cut it or the cable, and we could have lost the balloon, which is £1,000 worth of equipment. So I tried to pull it out and caught my hand in it. Took the top of my finger off.
I can see. Golly.
Took all my nails out. Lacerated my whole hand. And I had to be taken to Whips Cross Hospital. And that was the night there was a terrible raid on. And I think they kept me 2 hours sat in there with my hand in water. And then they had to send for my mum and dad because I got pneumonia set in from the shock. And then the next day, one of the crew came in and said, "We found the top of your finger," but it was too late. But my dad was quite annoyed because he said they should have cut it off to the joints because that looks disgusting now. He said, if they'd have cut it off to the joint, but they wouldn't because I expect they think you claim compensation. That was the only one of the airy moments. And while I was there in hospital, they had some rage, you know, and of course I couldn't bear to be inside. And they were just coming in. They were all up the corridors, all up the middle of the ward on stretchers and things. Oh, it was terrible, terrible. And one lady opposite me was having her baby and she was dying, you know, while she was very ill. Anyhow, she did die, and she had this little baby. I can see it now, because they used to bring it over to me to feed with the bottle, like, you know. It was a lovely little thing. Anyway, I came home on leave, and then I went back to the hospital after to see how this baby was. And the sister said it was going on all right, and they were keeping it there. And anyway, I used to go over quite a bit then to see it. And it was about 6 months after that she rang and told me that she was marrying the baby's daddy. She'd loved that baby so much. It was a lovely baby, although it had got a nasty big bump on its head, you know, and I thought it would never go, but she managed to nurse it till she'd got it down to normal.
It's a curious thing that there is no memorial to any of the women who fought in the war. Do you think there should be one?
I think they should be recognised in some way, really. I mean, I think they did did what they could as well as what the men did. I mean, it might have been a bit harder for the men in the trenches in that, you know, but I think, some of them were... I wouldn't say that the job I did wasn't dangerous. It was, at times, you know.
What form do you think it should take? Should it be a memorial or a garden or what?
I don't know, really. Either, I should think. A memorial would be nice, I think. You know, but I really don't know what to say about that, to be quite truthful.